see my lips move. I find that for many people, no matter how loud I might speak, they need to see things happening before they actually understand what I'm saying. My name is Reverend Warner Bloomfield. I'm the minister at Grace United Church, and I welcome you. As we prepare to enter into this time of reflection and praise, I offer a few words of scripture in the hopes that you may find some meaning and comfort in them. From the book of Deuteronomy, we read, "The eternal God is your dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms." From Psalm 27, "God is my light and my salvation. Whom then shall I fear? God is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" And from the Gospel of John, Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." God is with us. God's love unites us. God's purpose steadies us. God's Spirit comforts us. Blessed be God forever. Friends, we gather here in the protective shelter of God's healing love. We are free to pour out our grief, release our anger, face our emptiness, and know that God cares. We gather to comfort and to support one another in this time of loss, especially remembering John Lupson's family. We gather to hear God's word of hope that can drive away our despair and move us to offer praise to God. We gather to commend to God with thanksgiving the life of John Lupson as we celebrate the good news of Christ's resurrection. For whether we live or whether we die, we belong to Christ, who is Lord both of the living and of the dead. Let us pray. Holy God, whose ways are not our ways and whose thoughts are not our thoughts, we thank you that your Holy Spirit intercedes for us with sighs too deep for words. Heal hearts made heavy by the loss of John Lupson. Through our tears, assure us again that eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor human mind imagined what you have prepared for those who love you. Through Jesus Christ, the firstborn of the dead, from the dead. Amen. And dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. Let us confess our sins confident in God's love, so we continue to pray, God of the living and the dead. We are burdened by the things we have done, by the things we have not done. We remember our broken promises and missed opportunities, the gifts we have taken for granted, the love we have not shown or returned. Forgive us, comfort and heal us, lift our guilt from us, that we may walk in freedom and grace. Amen. Friends, the hope of the resurrection is that God loves us. Christ walks with us in the way, and the breath of the Spirit gives us new life. Thanks be to God. Greg and Carl prepared a few words and asked that I would read these. So I share this with you in remembrance of John. John was blessed by our dear Lord with 82 years of life. He lived life with energy, passion, and joy, and touched the lives of many. He started from humble beginnings in Toronto, where he was born in September of 1939. His family quickly learned the art of perseverance and survival, moving homes frequently while in Toronto. There was a time in Toronto where his family moved homes 24 times in 1 year. John's family relocated to London, Ontario, while he was still a young boy. His family had financial struggles while in London, and in 1946, at the age of 7, John was placed into the Protestant orphanage home for care. He spent 7 years in the orphanage, and despite his young age and formative years, he made the best of the situation, learning in the classroom during the day and chores in the evening. He learned to be disciplined at an early age. In an orphanage, you may be away from your parents, but you still need to make your bed, something he passed along to his two sons. Education was important to John. Once he left the orphanage, John pursued a technical education by attending H.B. Beale Technical School in London and graduated with a technical certificate. John was also extremely proud of his Canadian military service as a very young man. In 1956, he graduated from the Royal Canadian Air Force with a fighter control operator's diploma. He continued his military involvement with the Canadian Army in 1958 and 1959, becoming an officer cadet and remaining on emergency call-up until 1963. After pursuing a number of factory labor jobs, John finally received his calling from the Lord and pursued the ministry. His first role was the minister of Selkirk Baptist Church in Selkirk, where he shared the word of God for 2 years. He loved to speak with people every day and to be the uplifting voice of God's message when people became discouraged. In later years, while in Dunville, John would continue his ministry work as a certified lay preacher for the United Church of Canada with the Niagara Presbytery. John was thrilled to receive a phone call to continue his ministry work and cover sick days and holidays for various United Church ministers throughout the Niagara region, and on a few occasions here in Dunville at Grace United Church. John's life journey brought him to Dunville in 1974, and Dunville would become his home for the remainder of his life. His arrival in Dunville coincided with his passion for research and learning and education. John was proud of the 4 university degrees he was awarded: a Bachelor of Arts from the University of Waterloo, a Bachelor of Education from the University of Western Ontario, a Master of Religious Education from McMaster University, and a Master of Education from Brock University. John was a dedicated elementary school teacher, a profession where he taught in public schools for 26 years up until his retirement in 2001. John loved the classroom. He loved to teach children in the classroom and heaped praise upon them as the children grew throughout the school year, not only personally but physically too. He very much enjoyed the camaraderie amongst his fellow teachers and parents too, and many became close personal friends outside of the school environment. John was proud to circulate through the Dunville community and see his many, many former students around town years later. He was humbled in his gray hair days when former students would recognize him and shout across the street, "Hey, Mr. Lupson, how are you?" John was an extremely talented, graceful, and committed ballroom dancer. He was actively involved in every ballroom dancing event at the Burlington Legion and the Polish Hall in Burlington, and it was extremely rare for John to ever miss a special evening of ballroom dancing. He combined his love for ballroom dancing and teaching together to provide ballroom dancing lessons at the Burlington Legion. As both Carl and Greg would tell you, and as everyone here certainly knows, John had a very unique personality, and he certainly was not shy to share an unsolicited opinion on some aspect of your personal life. Getting into a debate with John Lupson was the mental equivalent of climbing into the ring with Hulk Hogan. You always knew that he would very quickly have you against the ropes. Defending yourself would be difficult. At some point, it would become painful. The battle would last a very long time, and at the end of the fight, you would inevitably just tap out in order to make it all stop. As his boys laughed and reminisced with me earlier on during our first meeting together, getting a lecture or a sermon from their father was not simply a once-a-week Sunday morning affair. Whether it was your car, your house, your finances, your health, or your family, you could always count on John to weigh in on what he felt you needed to do. Sometimes what he said made sense. Sometimes it appeared to be nonsense. Other times his words might even make you angry. But irrespective of how you felt after a conversation or an email with John Lutzen, you can guarantee that your mind would be focused much more broadly and intensely upon the decisions you needed to make. Good friends don't tell you what you want to hear, they help you make smart decisions, and John could always be counted on to help you make your own smart decision. And isn't that really the role of a preacher, a teacher? To ask you the tough questions that you don't want to ask of yourself or your family. And in so doing, help you consider making the important and difficult decisions that you don't want to make. Perhaps even taking the actions that you otherwise might not have taken. Perhaps it was this combination of a tough love upbringing married with a calling to the ministry and a career as an educator that drove John's desire to be so actively involved in other people's lives. I would suggest that it was never the precision of his words that everyone here appreciated most. It was the fact that the conversation would cause us all to think about what needed to be done and to do it. It was this desire to counsel others out of the true love in his heart and his unwavering support for others that we will remember John. Always there to lend an ear or extend a helping hand, never waiting for you to ask him for help. John was forever thankful and grateful that God blessed him with the opportunity to raise two wonderful sons, Carl and Greg. John, Carl, and Greg shared many special and memorable moments together. His sons meant everything in the world to him, and he was never so proud in life to talk about how Greg was doing with the RCMP or how Carl was doing in Bermuda. Both Carl and Greg loved their father dearly and will miss him immensely. Boys wish to thank you all for the love and support you showed their father over many years, often while they were away from home and John was on his own. Words cannot express how much they appreciate your loving support of John right up until the time of his passing. He will be dearly missed by all of us. Glory, glory, hallelujah. At this time, I would invite Kathy forward. Kathy has some words to share.
About John. A lot of it was just said, so now I'm going to wing it a little bit. So, you want me to take this off? Yeah? Anyway. So, John and I met about 13 years ago. I thought I wasn't going to do this. Anyway, about 13 years ago, I moved down to Brookfield, and one of the days I was out in the backyard doing some yard work, and over the fence, it's just a little fence at that time. John stuck his head over and said, "Hi, neighbor." And he introduced himself. And I was like, "Hi, how you doing?" You know, you make small talk and seem nice and everything was great. Finished up our conversation, went in the house. Little did I know that 13 years later, I would be up here talking about the man that we all knew and loved. He was a great teacher, everybody knows that. And he was always looking for an opportunity to teach us lessons, whether we wanted those lessons or not. he always had the best intentions. He was always all in. Whatever he wanted to do, whatever he wanted to help with, whatever he wanted, he was always 100% in. You could always count on him to do whatever is needed. All you had to do was ask. Half the time you didn't even have to ask, he just knew, so he would do it. There were so many stories that he would sit and tell us around the dining room table. Some were a little bit questionable, and some were very, very interesting, and there was always a lesson after the story, and if we weren't clear on it, he was clear to tell us what that lesson was. everybody here has a special place in his heart, and everybody has a different story to tell of John and what he meant to them. So, he stole a lot of my material, so, I was like, okay. to me. He was like a father to me. He was like a grandchildren, a grandfather to my children. He was one heck of a guy. And we're going to really miss your dad. And everybody here is going to miss him. We loved him. That wasn't the story I was going to tell, but anyway. So, anyway, thank you, John, for being the guy you were, and what we're going to always remember you as. A good friend.
Thank you, Kathy. I'd like to take an opportunity to provide anyone else if they have something they wish to share. Sometimes people take me up on that offer. Frequently not. It's not an easy thing to do. Thank you for sharing. But I do want to provide that option. If there's no one that wishes to say anything, and that's perfectly fine, we'll take a few moments of silence for people to remember in their own way, in their hearts. There are a few pieces of music that Greg and Carl wanted played as part of this service. And so the first of those is O Beulah Land, which we will now take time to listen to.
And someday only I'll stand where my home shall be eternal. Beulah land, sweet Beulah land.
Another passage of scripture at this time comes from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. May these words be blessed to our understanding. I didn't know John Lutzen, but after talking with Greg and Carl, I am struck by a man who loved his family, loved his community, and loved his God. He was grateful for the life he was provided and the people who came into his life. The scripture I just read speaks of Jesus encouraging his followers to hold on to their saltiness, to let their light shine so that it provides light to the whole house. This particular passage follows immediately from the Beatitudes portion of the Sermon on the Mountain, the part of Matthew where Jesus speaks of who is blessed. Blessed are the meek. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are the peacemakers and those who are persecuted. And he immediately then tells those followers, you are the salt of the earth. God sees your value in just who you are. Don't hide that, but let who you are be a blessing to the world. Jesus is speaking to fishermen, laborers, women, and children, slaves, those who are commonly left on the outside looking in when it comes to making decisions about society, people who rarely had a voice and were typically seen as suspicious and generally of no use by the elite of society. And yet, these are the people Jesus looks upon and says, carry the light of God. They are blessed by God to play a leading role in transforming the world into the society of love, justice, and peace that God envisions for us all. John Lutzen strikes me as a man who embraced who he was, where he came from, and and shared the blessings of that life with those he loved. He worked to make his community better. He found joy in getting to know his neighbors. He was a teacher. He was a lay preacher. He was dedicated to learning, both his own learning and helping others to further their own learning. John was blessed by God, and he worked to be a blessing to the world around him. He did not lose his saltiness. Sure, I have no doubt all of you know that much better than I do, even. And he did not hide his light. Now, I have no doubt John's death comes as a shock, and I am also certain his passing leaves a significant hole in the lives of a great many people. We celebrate his life and the immense impact he had on so many people, but we cannot diminish the pain his passing brings. That is simply the nature of losing someone who was so important. And we are grateful for their place in our lives and grieve their loss. A German pastor and theologian by the name of Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was killed by the Nazis during World War II, spoke of the pain and grief that accompanies the death of a loved one. I want to quote him here. There is nothing that can replace the absence of someone dear to us, and one should not even attempt to do so. One must simply hold out and endure it. At first, that sounds very hard. But at the same time, it is also a great comfort. For to the extent the emptiness remains, truly remains unfilled, one remains connected to the other person through it. It is wrong to say that God fills the emptiness. God in no way fills it, but much more leaves it precisely unfilled and thus helps us preserve, even in pain, the authentic relationship. Furthermore, the more beautiful and full the remembrances, the more difficult the separation. But gratitude transforms the torment of memory into silent joy. One bears what was lovely in the past, not as a thorn, but as a precious gift. Deep within, a hidden treasure of which one can always be certain. For John, we are grateful that he is joined all that much more intimately with his Creator. We celebrate his life, but we also take time to recognize who he was and what he meant to us. We share his stories and hold up those values he promoted and passed on to his community. Values of service, love, learning. Values of compassion, wisdom. Those who knew and loved John Lupson were changed through that relationship. You are in part because of that relationship. You are who you are in part because of that relationship. For that you can be grateful. Who he was, what he valued, what he worked to achieve lives on through your honoring of his memory. Our Christian faith tells us our stories continue after death. That we have a life beyond death. I cannot say what that life looks like, but I am assured we are embraced by our loving Creator. John Lupson is now more fully embraced by God, and we offer our thanks to God for his life and all he worked for and represented during his life with us. So I want to conclude with another passage of Scripture. And this one is from Paul's letter to the Philippians. It comes in chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. Do not worry about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. As I began by saying, I did not know John Lutzen, except through the stories shared by his sons, Carl and Gray. But what I have learned tells me the story of a man who lived out his faith to share God's good news of steadfast and unconditional love. He lived a life of love, faith, and compassion. For that, we can say, thanks be to God. Amen. Let us pray. God of grace and glory, we thank you for John Lutzen, who was near and dear to those gathered here, and who now has died. We thank you for the friendship he gave and for the strength and peace he brought. We thank you for the love he offered and received while he was with us here. We pray that nothing good in the life of this man will be lost, but will be of benefit to the world. That all that was important to him will be respected by those who follow, and that everything he valued will continue to mean much to us now that he has died. We ask you that he may live on in the hearts and minds of his family and friends, inspiring courage, informing conscience. We ask you that we who were close to him may now, because of this death, be even closer to one another, and that in peace and friendship here on earth, we may always be deeply conscious of your promise to be faithful to us in death. We pray for ourselves who are tested by this death, that we do not try to minimize the loss or seek refuge from it in words alone, nor brood over it so that it overwhelms us and isolates us from others. God of grace and glory, grant us courage and confidence, and hear us as we join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us, our Father, who art in heaven. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Take time for another piece of music. We have an anchor.
Thank you.
To your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, John Lovson. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, and a son of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. For you, I say, may God bless and keep you. May God's face shine on you and be gracious to you. And may God look on you with kindness and give you peace. Amen. Now I believe you're going to proceed to a time of committal now. In the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Savior, Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our brother, John Lovson, and we commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Go forth on your journey, John Lovson. Go forth from this world. Go forth from this world. Go in the name of God, the Holy One who created you. Go in the name of Christ, the Holy One who bled for you, and go in the name of the Spirit, the Holy One who anointed you. Go on your course, and may your place today be found in peace, and may your dwelling be forever within the heart of God. And I conclude with another prayer. Consoling God, our refuge in trouble, our strength in sorrow, by dying our Lord Jesus Christ conquered death. By rising from the grave, he restored us to life. Enable us to go forward in faith to meet him, that when our life on earth is ended, we may be united in love, where every tear shall be wiped away. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Go in the peace of Christ. Amen.
I would just like to thank everybody for coming today, for showing their support for Greg and Carl, as well as celebrating John's life. As this is the conclusion of our service here today, I would invite everybody that is able to please stand, and I'll invite Greg and Carl to make their way out to the front with me, where you'll have a chance to visit with them on your way out. Thank you.